Aloha mai kakou, kia ora. I am Leanne Ferrer, Executive Director of Pacific Islanders and Communications. Thank you for spending time with us for an intimate conversation about Stan, featuring filmmaker Mitchell Hawks and New Zealand music and acting idol Stan Walker. This special event is presented by Pacific Islanders in Communications and the World Channel. I would like to start with a land acknowledgement. I am here today calling from the occupied lands of the Kanaka Maoli, whose kingdom was illegally overthrown by the United States in 1893, but who never relinquished our claims as a sovereign nation. As with many Indigenous communities, Aina, land, is an important part of all we do. In our origin beliefs, land is in fact our older brother. Thus, wherever we are, we open space by acknowledging the land we are on and our ancestors whose wisdom, resilience, pride, and aloha have been passed through our DNA to enlighten generations to come and steadfastly maintain the sovereignty of our people. This year marks the 30th anniversary of Pacific Islanders in Communications. We are proud and honored to be the only national public media organization that is committed to supporting, advancing, and developing Pacific Island media content and talent. We are also celebrating the 10th consecutive season of Pacific Heartbeat. Pacific Heartbeat is an anthology series that provides viewers with a glimpse of the real Pacific, its people, cultures, languages, music, and contemporary issues. With us today is filmmaker Mitchell Hawks, the main subject of Stan Walker, and moderator Alex Lee, who is the director of the DocEdge International Documentary Film Festival Industry. He is a speaker and a juror at many international screen festivals. Alex, thank you for moderating.
Aloha and kia ora. Tihe Māori ora, inga mana, inga reo, ira rangatira mā. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Ko manga whāta maunga, ko tamaki ta awa, ko ahia toko iwi, ko DocEdge te waka, ko Alex the Ahau. Thank you so much, Pacific Islanders and Communication and World Channel, for hosting this. It is with great pleasure that I take this opportunity to moderate the session about the film Stan and to be able to bring onto the platform both the director, Mitchell Hawks, and our music icon, Stan Walker. Stan is one of the highest rating documentaries that's played on broadcast television. It has an incredible following of people due to not only the fact that it features Stan, but the message that it's carrying. It won the Best Feature Documentary at the DocEdge International Film Festival 2018. But wait, that's not all. It won for Best New Zealand Director, which is Mitchell Hawks. It also won for Best New Zealand Editing, and it won for Best New Zealand Cinematography. It is with great pleasure that I will call Stan onto the platform. For those of you already in the know, and I think most of you will be, that Stan's music career was launched in 2009, where as a 19-year-old, he won Australian Idol. Since then, we claimed him back. He has released 5 albums and won numerous music awards. He is one of our own sons, one of our own New Zealand children. As a man, he leans heavily on his faith, his Maori culture, and his mother to fight a unique and potentially fatal cancer that's killed more than 25 people in his immediate family. This is a really important film because since the film has been made, it has also brought to light how this particular form of cancer has affected other people and has inspired other people to actually take necessary action to be able to remedy the situation. So welcome, Stan. If I get Stan to bring himself up onto the screen. Yeah, kia ora, Stan.
Kia ora, kia ora.
And then I like to invite Mitchell to come on as well. As we said, Mitchell is the best New Zealand director for the Film Stan. He specializes in emotional stories that deal with big concepts. He filmed a story about our transgender teen born this way, which saw him win Best Director at the 2017 New Zealand Television Awards. He has won Best Multicam Director for Vodafone in New Zealand Music Awards. And in 2019, he won Best Multicam Award for Araha Nui URS. So welcome, Stan. Oh, Joe, sorry. Welcome, Mitchell. Mitchell. Sorry, I'm a bit early in the morning. Anyway. Thank you so much. Now, maybe to start off the conversation, it is always the first conversation that anyone working in the film industry would always ask is, how did the both of you get together? How did it become the conversation that, hi, you know, I like to make the story. Would you like to make the story? Yes, I would, you know, and then the picture actually started taking form.
I actually went talked to a friend of mine who was working. I worked with him on X Factor, Andrew Schusterman. And I basically went in and I decided for myself that I wanted to document the whole process because I feel like there's a lot of times when you hear stories like this, there's two ways, you live or you die. And I wanted to document the whole process from the beginning to the end, from the recovery, you know, how people actually go through these things. And for me, I'm a creative person. This was another outlet for me to be able to express myself and still have, you know, even though I was going to be in hospital and beds most of my time, I wanted to still do something that that meant something, that it was creative for me. So I thought, oh, let's film me while I'm in pain. And so I met with Andrew, and it was like I said, oh, basically I've got cancer, I'm getting my stomach out in a week's time. Do you want to film this? And then he got a hold of Mitchell, and we just started filming. There was like, we kind of didn't really have a plan. We just had to go into it because it was happening so quick. And Mitchell and them, they just came down, filmed my last gig, and then it was all on.
Mitchell,
yeah, so I'd worked with Stan on and off, like in various things. So I worked on X Factor, so I knew him from that, and worked on a couple of other shows. I remember one of the first things that I ever did, I don't know, Stan, if you singing the World Cup, the football World Cup song. Do you remember that?
Yes. That's right.
So that was like, yeah. I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, and Stan would have been young. Right, and so right. I was involved in this. It was quite a low budget music video kind of thing. But anyway, sort of worked with him on and off throughout that period. And when, Andrew Schusterman approached us, I think probably we had a relationship with him, and probably on the basis of our documentary Awa that we had just finished filming and had won some awards. So I think Andrew approached us. And I think Stan was in Palmerston North, and there was no funding, no money, no concept, no nothing. It's like, get in the car, get a camera person, drive down to Palmerston North. Stan was in his hotel room. We turned up with a camera crew, and that's how the documentary actually opens. That with Stan sitting in his hotel room is us, I don't know, finding out maybe 48 hours after we knew that there was a documentary being made or to be made.
So the both of you knew each other, but you would had to have developed some kind of strong trust relationship between the two of you, because it is a very intimate story. It deals with something that's very personal to Stan. And so, you know, there has to be a development of a relationship that will allow Stan to feel entirely comfortable revealing everything about himself and his family to you, Mitchell. And how did you think that was achieved in terms of being able to develop the relationship? I'd love to hear from both of you how that was achieved.
Well, to a certain extent, and one of the reasons why, you know, we were in the middle of filming a whole lot of other things at the time, and one of the reasons that I said yes to this documentary is Stan is very special in the way that he communicates, and he's very charismatic. And he's very open. So to a certain extent, I didn't have to build a relationship because Stan is open, I think, to that. And then so the next part was just to talk about how we were going to portray him and make sure. And I think, yeah, so that's what we worked on the making of the relationship, is making sure that the story represented him, represented what Stan wanted to say. So that's what we built on. But as far as that openness and that ability to communicate, I think Stan's naturally got that, and that's why we wanted to do the documentary.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was quite easy. Like Mitchell said, I'm quite open. If I decide I'm going to do something, I'm going all in. I did warn them, though. I was like, you know, get in my face. There's going to be times where I'm going to, like, they're going to annoy me. And I'm like, I don't want you in there. You got to stay there. So I warned them on those parts, and I did get like that. Oh, they used to annoy me, and the camera's in my face, and I'm in pain. I'm tired. But it was cool. And they're such, like, the whole crew just became whānau, and it was it was so beautiful to take them on that journey with me as well. And you know, there was still a lot of stuff that still happened when they went away, and they didn't catch the good juicy moments where the relapsing and all these different things. But no, it was easy for me. I feel like I've got really nothing to hide, and I just wanted people to see all of that happens in between, from being sick to getting better, like the everything, all of that. And they were awesome for that, and they made it easy for me. Sometimes I forget they were there. They'd be just filming in the corner sweating.
That's great. I mean, let's have a look at the trailer for those of you in the audiences that haven't actually seen it yet, but if you haven't, you need to make sure you do. Sarah, thank you.
The biopsies have revealed that there is a small focus of cancer confined to the single layer of the stomach.
Yeah, this whole hill, we've all been struck by this ugly curse, this ugly gene. This is my Koro George's house. He's dead now. This is Nanny Pat, my nan's sister. She's dead.
This is my grandfather here. He had the gene, he had the cancer, and he died from the operation. Yeah, I'm getting my whole stomach out. It's a little bit exciting because I'm going to be skinny for the rest of my life.
Yeah, me and Stan, we've got a special relationship. Don't tell me that. I just got to block it out so I can be strong for Stan, with Stan, you know, and help him.
I know tomorrow's going to change my life. It's going to change everything.
Don't cry.
Thank you, Father in heaven, that you just keep him safe in Jesus' name.
Yeah, I'm not keen on dying. I wanna live.
So that was the trailer, guys. If you haven't seen it, you need to make sure you watch the film. But the film is an extraordinary stand, and you were very open in the film. You raised awareness of a very important topic, and through what you have done, you've also not only just impacted people around New Zealand, but even within your own family. You have found that a number of your own whānau have actually taken the step and gone and had their stomachs removed. Do you want to talk about that, Stan?
Yeah, I mean... It's nothing new in our family, this gene, and you know, people getting cancer and people getting their stomach out, but it's definitely made us a bit scared, you know. People are scared. They're scared to find out if they've got the gene. They're scared to ever go through the possibility of, you know, getting the operation. And like me and my family, is me, my mum, my dad, my brothers and sisters, we're very, we can turn a situation around and laugh about it. And I think we use humour a lot to save us. And so, you know, because we did that through the pain, I mean, you know, it is, we have a lot of trauma from this. We've lost a lot of people. Like, there's hundreds of our family members that have died of this. So, you know, people grow up with this trauma, you know, I might be next. But because we've come so far in terms of science and how we can get it removed. It is quite a simple thing, even though it's not a simple thing, but compared to dying and not knowing why, to now getting it out and you can live a full life and be incredible and never ever have to go on a diet. we like it's definitely encouraged people, even my family watching the documentary, because they know, but they saw it in a different way. So like since then I've had a few cousins and family members get their stomachs out, and I mean they're never ever going to have to worry about that ever again, because once it's out, that's it, it's done. So it's been a beautiful thing to see, not just my family, but people all around the country and people who have seen the documentary identify the same gene in their family or similar genes, and they're alive now because of that. So I would do it all over again to save people and to see my family hope for a better future for their own selves.
That's extraordinary. And I know that both yourself and Mitchell, you've both had requests from every week or every other week. People have been saying, can we watch this film? Can we learn more about it? Because the film has had social impact, hasn't it?
Yeah, it honestly has. Like, it's like people, like even I was saying before, I talked to one lady who goes around the country and does breast screening, and especially with Māori and Pacific Polynesian women, it's a tapu thing, you know. They don't want to get their bodies touched or looked at, and you know, sometimes it's just that's the difference between them being alive and them dying. And they anyway, this lady uses the documentary as a tool to kind of encourage and make it all good. And, you know, it actually helps our women around Aotearoa. They feel more comfortable when they watch the documentary, and they feel like that they have the strength to do that, you know, that they can do it. And it's a simple thing just to save their lives. So, and just schools, universities, and yeah, it's been awesome.
Mitchell, in telling a story as personal as this, I mean, were there any sort of principles that you kept following to make sure that you were authentic to the story, sensitive to what was going on, and also at the same time, you know, being able to recognize yourself as someone, as a filmmaker who's got certain ethics and values in terms of what you wanted to show? I mean, could you share that, your thinking around this?
Yeah, well, I think there's a good scene in the documentary that actually is us finding the boundaries and me doing it in a way that and knew that wouldn't be risky, that wouldn't do anything to the relationship, but it's kind of, it really sort of explains Stan and what we could do, you know, because I have, there's a lot of, that's really important to me to make a documentary that is ethically true to somebody, and we show it to, the documentaries I've worked on, I show to the subjects before it screens to make sure that they're happy with things, and that's just something that I believe if they're giving me their story, then it's my duty to give it back to them to say, does this reflect your story? Because it's not my story. Anyway, there was one moment in there when Stan, after he'd had the operation and he was hacking and spitting up into the sink and stuff, and he went off to the bathroom, and I could hear on my headphones that he was spitting into the bathroom, and Bevan, the cameraman, he was like, do we go in there? Is that like invading his privacy while he's spitting into the sink? So the camera, and this is in the documentary, the camera comes around the corner into the bathroom, films Stan spitting in the sink. He doesn't know we're there. He turns around, sees the camera, and just cracks up laughing. And I kind of think that's, you know, where, you know, that was, I thought that Stan would be fine with that. It's not something that would normally, you know, that is a private thing, but obviously Stan was completely fine with that shot.
Stan, was the film what you expected? Looking back at it,
it was. I've watched it a few times. I felt like it was just shot beautifully. My story was told how I wanted it to be told. The history, the science, the family, the, you know, it had everything. And even the way that, you know, because I talked about my grandfather a lot in there, and because of my grandfather, there thousands and thousands and thousands of people all over the world are going to live if they have the same gene as us because of my grandfather. And he was the sacrifice for us. And just how that was told, like, even like now, it makes me emotional because I, like, he was, like, I always go back and I look at all these graves and I look at all the people who've got their stomachs out. I'm like, far, my grandfather did that. So watching that, it's still like, I'm still so overwhelmed every time I see it when it comes to my grandfather and what he did, and just seeing the old footage of him alive and you know, what he was doing behind the scenes that nobody knew. There was only a few of them, him and my nannies, that he had made. He had done a kawenata. A kawenata is basically, it's a contract between you and God, and he had to go back to Ratanapa, where he's from, and go to the church and do a contract, because he was going, what he wanted to do and what he was about to do was going against everything of who we are as Māori people and who he was and his belief. And so he had to do a contract basically saying that he was going to give up his life, sacrifice his life and his body in a way that goes against our cultural beliefs and our culture to save us. And he said that to my nannies, I don't want my kid, my mokos, my grandchildren to go through that. I want them to live. So that for me is probably the most powerful thing. And just seeing the transformation of me physically and me mentally, and there was, it's quite, I like watching it. Like, you got Big Stan munching everything in the world, like eating everything till he couldn't breathe, and then now Skinny Stan and just never have to go on a diet. Like, I love watching that journey, and like, me and my family always laugh at it. We're laughing. I'm like, oh, there's the big boy.
Yeah, absolutely. And you do have a very special relationship with your family, and in particular, you are very close to your mum. And I like to move to the first clip that we're going to show, which is about you and your mum. So, Sarah, if you can play that, please. Thank you.
I'm really close to my mum, like, really close. Like, I'm definitely her favourite. But we're the closest for so many reasons, because we're the same. We've been through the same things. I think we've come out of ugly places. She's been with me, obviously, since day dot. She's my mum. But, like, in terms of my career and everything that I do, I couldn't do anything without my mum.
This is quite emotional. I don't think it's going to be that emotional. Oh.
I don't really like thinking about, I don't like to think about the bad things that will happen if my mum doesn't get her stomach out, but I can't help but think, you know? I just don't want her to do it when it's too late. So the quicker that my mum, and then Uncle Fiddy as well, get their stomachs out, the better it is for us. And for them, obviously. Like, I don't want them to die. I won't cope at all. Not saying that my mum's gonna die, but, like, you know, I'm a strong person. I've always been strong, but not when it comes to my mum. I won't cope at all. So if anything ever happened, yeah, that would be the end of me.
Yeah, it's nice.
Such a powerful scene, Stan. I mean, you both went through rites of passage in your lives, and that's quite an important scene, I think, which helps us understand how close you are, not just with your mother, but with your family and culture at the same time. There was a question that was asked, you know, they wanted to know whether or not your uncle has gotten his surgery. And I know that, you know, some of your family members have as well. So the question is, again, you know, how has it impacted your family? Has it, and who has taken the steps towards taking the surgery now?
There's been a lot of my family who have got their stomachs out since. I've got a lot of young cousins got their stomachs up because, you know, them finding out that they had cancer too. Others also just taking their stomachs out to prevent anything from happening. My uncle hasn't got a stomach out yet, but that's still in the making. It's been a process with my uncle because he had to get healthy. He had to get his teeth done, and he had to get a good home because he was living kind of poorly. And so he's finally in a good home. He's in our papakaina. Our papakaina are houses that are built for our families on our lands. So, you know, we've got a good system to house and home our families. So he's in there now. And so now I believe that he should be on the road to getting his stomach out. My mum, she's hasn't got her stomach out, but I'm still trying to encourage her. I think for my mum and my uncle, they have a more recent trauma, you know, watching their dad die and die in an ugly way and how he did, and watching their uncles and aunties die and cousins die. So their trauma, I can't really compare with mine. So they live in a bit more fear than me. Me, I'm just like, get it out. I'm over it. I'm a little bit more impulsive, and I'll just go ahead and do it than my uncle and my mum. And then my mum watching me going through it kind of was all more traumatic. But they're definitely, I mean, my uncle's definitely closer to getting his stomach out, and a lot of people are getting their stomachs out. And in an easier way now, I mean, it's never easy, to be honest, it's never easy, but the process now is like, it's so much more easier than what it was 10 years ago.
There is a question that follows up from that is, do you know if there is testing that's going on from young age in your family? Like, are they being screened from birth to being a toddler now? You know, because you know that it is something that's going to happen in your family.
So you get tested for the gene to see if you have the gene from, I think, 14 or 15. So you just get tested. It's a blood test, and they see if the gene is within you. If you don't have the gene, then it stops at you.
Sorry, go on.
I'm just saying, in my family, it's just me and my mum who have the gene. My brothers and my sister and dad don't have the gene.
Mm. Okay.
So they will never, ever carry that on.
Yeah.
If when it stops at you, it stops at you.
Yeah. The question that's been raised following that is that, you know, do you have any advice for those across the Pacific that may have fears about testing for the gene? I mean, I suppose some people are afraid to know. And then after you know, some people are afraid about taking the step and having the operation. So, you know, what advice do you have to people across the Pacific in those situations?
I mean, my life is proof that finding out and knowing, I'm living now my best life. I was always scared of the possibility of getting my stomach out and that it's going to be hard. And, you know, I'm not saying that it's easy. I'm not saying that it's been an easy road. There's been times where I've wanted to give up and it's been hard, not even physically, mentally. But it's better to know, because then you're not just responsible for yourself. If you want to become a parent, you need to know so that your kids know. It is daunting, it is scary, but I mean, I wouldn't have it any other way. Like, I can honestly, like, it's changed my life, it's saved my life. That you just got to think it can save your life. And honestly, life can be so amazing. Life can be hard, life can be tough, even finding out that stuff, it can be really hard, but I'm so glad and I'm so better for it. Like, I'm living my best life ever. And so yeah, I think just, you can't go living in fear and living in the unknown, because then you possibly won't be able to reach your full potential, and you could be not doing anybody a favor, and you could get this gene and get sick or whatever. So I think just find out as quick as possible, get it sorted. It's like you have to get these little things done so that you get a better and bigger life.
There was a question, and I just wondered whether you have a blog where you're sharing your diet, nutrition, and your health regimen right now, because a lot of people that might go through that might want to look to someone and see what they're doing, what they're eating, how they're living their lives, so that they can use that as a role model for their own.
I don't blog or anything about anything that I eat. My eating is quite bad sometimes. I kind of eat everything. I just eat little bits at a time. I just kind of pick. But I know for me and for everybody, like me and my cousins always talk about it. I was just talking about, there's about four of us who got no stomachs, and we were catching up. And we were just like, oh, yeah, I don't like eating this, or I can't eat that. Some water's been really hard to get used to. I can drink fizzy drink and everything like that, but water was really hard to drink. I couldn't keep it down. It felt very heavy. I feel like I eat generally good, except when I'm out, but a lot of veggies, meat. I feel like red meat, I can feel it going down my bottom, but down my body, sorry. So it's quite hard for that, but I just generally eat a lot of veggies, chicken, and I just stay away from a lot of fatty foods, oily foods, because I get sick. It makes me sick, but sometimes I'll sacrifice it for the taste. I'm like, okay, I know I'm going to get sick for 20 minutes, but I'm going to do it. Sometimes you just got to have a little taste.
and with that, we should play the clip about your last meal.
What did you put on? Avocado?
Just mayo.
Maybe this is the last time I'm going to eat, okay? Joke. Oh, Mary, I want those noodles. Can you make us some?
They can be arranged.
So awesome having a beautiful sister.
The hard thing about it now is just, you know, my family. You know, we've just gone through my mum. You know, she's still recovering from breast cancer. And that was a bit of a blow to our family. And then now me. Oh, man, I'm a machine. This can't even fit in my gut, eh? I know that my family won't even talk about it as much, or, like, you know, act like nothing's happened. It's all good. But I know that it's hard for them, especially my mum and dad.
Well, you'll have a good sleep.
When?
Under anaesthetic. You won't feel the pain, bruh. That's why he's saying.
Yes, I will feel the pain.
No, you won't.
Mum, he's taking up my stomach and reconnecting stuff.
Get off there.
Get off.
Oh, gosh. It's a bit daunting, that's for sure.
Yeah, far out.
Mitchell, when you were making the film, beginning, obviously, you just when you started filming, when did the story start taking shape for you? When did you know the way the narrative was going to go for you?
It was always a challenge, because all we knew was that, you know, Stan was going to have an operation and then we would follow that. And one of the issues was that a lot of it took place in Australia and we were in New Zealand. So it was a sort of trying to figure out how to make that work, like when we would fly over and be with him. And then... yeah, there was just the difficulties. And so a lot of those difficulties that Stan had, he filmed himself on a phone, which was, they really work for the story. And then I think that stage when Stan was talking about the difficult, when he wasn't so interested in the documentary, was during after all that hardship he'd been through, and he went to, and maybe Stan can talk about what Rarotonga meant to him. Mm. But we basically stalked him to, that was the place where Stan was maybe like on his own journey of recovery, and we were on our journey of this is the end. Well, one possible journey, you know, part of the journey is Stan's first concert back after performing. And yeah, maybe Stan can say, because I know that Rarotonga means a lot to you.
Because it was my first concert back, and I didn't tell my friends that I had cancer. They just got a shock when they saw me. And I was like, because they'd flown me and my band over and the boys. And when we got there, I was like, oh, I just want to let you know, like, just in case, you know, obviously I look way different. I had cancer, and so blah, 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 got my stomach out, and they were shocked. I'm not very good at breaking news, and news like that, it's like, oh, yeah, I've got cancer, or I had cancer, or something like that. And I was like, I don't even know if I can sing, but don't worry, on the day, I think I'll turn up. And they were just like, what? And so I actually, even at sound check, I couldn't sing at all. And then when my voice came out on the night, like, as soon as I opened up my voice, it came out, and lucky it was raining, I just started crying because I was like, oh, thank you, God. I thought my voice was gone forever. And yeah, just Rara has always been like just a beautiful place. And then Mitchell and everybody, the crew came, and I was like, oh, here we go, you're going to ruin my holiday. I was going there to get away from everything and everyone, and I just wanted to just celebrate and live my life. And they just, they came along.
Oh. And I know that when I was watching the film, I mean, it was very real, right? This fear about what was going to happen to your voice, because your voice is a precious instrument. It's a gift, a taonga that was given to you by our maker. And obviously taking the step of getting your stomach removed, and we're just wondering exactly what effect there was, would have been a huge big consideration for you. But, you know, from the looks of it, you know, your voice is back to its great best again. But talk us through, I mean, what was going through your mind at the time? Because, you know, your voice is your gift to the world. Your voice is your business as well, you know. So there must have been so much going on in your mind at that time.
I mean, the biggest thing is I was just incredibly frustrated, and I was angry. And I expected my voice to come back just like that. I'm a very impatient person. I want things done then and there. And I was expecting it to just come back just like that. And it wasn't. And that was probably the most emotional and frustrating and scary thing for me. It was the possibility of losing my voice forever. I wasn't really worried about, like, you know, the stomach and if I was going to die or not. And I mean, I almost died a few times. But that wasn't a fear for me. That wasn't emotional for me. It was the one thing that I had, the one thing that got me into this life, it got me through this life and made a career for me, as my voice. And I just thought it was gone forever. And then when I came back, and now my voice is so much more powerful and bigger and better than I ever had before. And I thought, oh my gosh, you know, having a stomach, that's going to help me. I don't know. Being a skinny little thing that's bigger than it's bigger now than ever.
We're so grateful that, you know, your voice has recovered, because you've got so many fans around the world, and just being able to hear you sing and sing well again is tremendous. It's you know, something quite special. So, you know, thank you for recovering that way, Stan. It's great for all of us. tell me, What do the both of you hope for the film? I mean, it has impact. I mean, obviously, you know, films, you create dialogue, you want to create impact. I know for Stan, from what you have been saying, Stan, is that, you know, the impact is trying to get people to take the step to get tested, to do what they need to do to improve their lives. But I think it's bigger than that. I think it's bigger than just the gene. It's bigger than just the cancer. Yeah. You know, your message is much bigger than that. And obviously, Mitchell, in terms of filmmaker, what do you hope the film will do? You would have an impact strategy, or at least an impact goal in your mind when you made this film. So, you know, maybe you can share that with us, both of you.
Yeah, well, I always think, you know, whether it's writing, I don't write song lyrics, but I think about when song lyrics and in documentary, when you get specific, the specificity becomes the global. And so that was the story, you know, that was what was happening here. And the specificity was Stan's family and that gene. And that is absolutely crucial to Stan and his whānau. And that's a great story to tell. But immediately it comes out to, you know, we know that, like Stan was talking about, Māori not necessarily going to get checked because you know, because tapu parts of your body, etc. And so you immediately it zooms out to that. But then just straight out from that, you just you end up with humans. It's like all of us do not go to the doctor or do preventative checks that we do. You know, that's one of the major problems that we have. People aren't getting breast cancer or prostate checks or whatever it is. And that's what the big picture of this documentary is Stan faced up to the fact that, I mean, it was hard and there was a lot of prompting, but he faced up to the fact that he needed to do something before it was too late. And that's what a lot of us need to actually do. And that's what I think you can take away from the documentary.
Hmm. And what about you, Stan? I mean, apart from, you know, obviously getting the checks, you know, is there a bigger message that you want to take out to the world with the film and your journey?
Yeah, I mean, because I was before my stomach, getting my stomach out, I've never been supportive of organizations that raise money for cures. I've always been a skeptic, and I'm, you know, I've always been like that. What I don't know, I don't know. And so I'm just going to immediately think, where's that money going? I am the byproduct of science and the advancement of science. I'm a byproduct of that. I'm alive because of science and because of the money that's being given, and so that they can keep finding new ways, better ways and cures. Before that, you know, it was literally opening up your whole stomach. And I was I'm the first one in my whole family to get keyhole surgery. And I don't know how they got my big stomach out of my belly button, but they did. And they pulled out a little bit of fat. But I just want people to see it from a lens like, you know, I was a scared person. I was one that wasn't forward, and I could have lived on my life and would have died if I just ignored it. I was everything that maybe a lot of people are. And so just to see that, you know, life on the other side is actually so much more brighter. I mean, sometimes you have to go through the valleys and everything to get to the mountain peak. And so just I just want to encourage people that, you know, that your health is like, that's, man, look after yourselves, get yourself checked, and don't live in fear and then get nothing done and then die for some dumb reason. Like, people in my family have died for not getting checked. They've died and their life has been cut off because they didn't get checked. Man, live life, get checked. I just want to encourage everybody, and that also, like, that, you know, a lot of people, especially within my family, we grew up thinking that it was a makutu, it was a curse, but it just actually came down to genes. So getting our family checked, that it wasn't just this big curse on our family, on our land, it was actually a genetic mutation within our whānau, and we traced where it came from, and that now we can save our family. So, you know, sometimes you just have to go in that way, because we live in such a diverse world that, you know, we only have remnants of the old. And so we got to live in this new world where you got to go and get stuff checked.
Yeah. Thanks, Stan. Yeah, Mitchell.
Well, yeah, it's just kind of interesting from Stan's perspective there, because it's not necessary. Well, it's not a traditional perspective. And somebody we interviewed in the documentary did a big bit about the makatū and the curse on the hill. And Stan talked to me afterwards and said, you know, I don't believe that, and I don't want that as part of, you know, in science, we can get this checked. That's the message. And because, you know, Stan, it's his story, and I'm Pākehā, so it's not, you know, to me, that seems interesting. This interview that we did where a person is saying the hill is cursed, you know, and that's why it's there. I'm like, you know, that seems an interesting thing. But Stan took the lead for the documentary and said, I think it's talked about in there briefly, but it's not given as the reason. Science is the reason what this story is about.
Cool. Before we close, we have a third clip that we will play, and then we'll come back. So thank you for organizing a third clip to play right now.
Uncle Tahi. He's been a health inspiration for both my mum and myself.
Oh, this one's nice, hey?
It's different.
Really nice.
Nutritional yeast is used as a flavouring for vegan dishes.
Hey.
Yeah.
He was the first call, you know, when I found out I had cancer. And he rang me up and he goes, boy, we can heal our bodies with our kai and everything like that.
See, ever since I got my stomach out, I think it was actually the second operation that really turned me off food. But now, even looking at a burger, if I smell it, I can spew up. Now I crave like broccoli, blooming spuds, and kumara, and onions. I needed to go back there and see him and see what he does and see how he lives so that it could help me and also learn too. I feel like a lot of our people and a lot of people in the world today, including myself, are constantly abusing our bodies and are constantly abusing ourselves, and we're not living to our full potential. We're eating crap, and that crap is, you know, doing things to our bodies. It's making us lethargic, it's affecting our brains, and it's affecting the way that we see ourselves and like just function in everyday life, you know, our mental state. It's affecting everything. But like, I'm at the beginning of my journey and I'm starting to understand more and I'm starting to get it more that it's so important to look after myself. And here I am about to have a lolly.
I went to pick and take and got these are so young.
Like I said, I'm at the beginning of my journey.
And you've certainly progressed a great deal from the beginning of your journey. Now, before I invite Leanne to come back, just want to know, Stan, what's your favorite food today? What's the one thing that you dream about having, or that's kind of your must-have on your diet? And it's okay, because you did say that sometimes we all lapse, and sometimes even the smell, just the taste is important. But what's that one thing that, you know, really gets you?
I love all my Māori and island food. It's my favorite. Lived in Raro and Rarotonga for 2 years, and ikamata every morning, every day. But I can only eat it fresh, because I tried a raw fish one time and I usually like it the next day. Oh, no. I learned a hard lesson. I had a little bit and then I was like, oh, I feel a little bit weird. Oh, I started spewing out on both ends at the same time. But this is the reality. But now I know, like, everything got to be fresh. So, but like, yeah, island food, oh, all day.
Yep. Great. I mean, I think that the lesson we learned from the clip as well is that we all should be mindful about what we do to our bodies and how we treat it, because our body is our temple. We should worship it. We should worship it correctly. And I wanted to thank the both of you, but I want to invite Leanne Ferrer from Pacific Islanders in Communication to come back so that we can both thank everyone at the same time. Leanne.
Thank you again to both Stan and Mitchell for having a conversation with us, and to Alex for moderating this wonderful discussion. And thank you to everyone who's joined us for this special event presented by Pacific Islanders in Communications and the World Channel. You can watch Stan on your local PBS stations and online. To learn more about Pacific Islanders in Communications, please visit www.piccom.org. And Alex, I'm going to throw it back to you if Mitchell or Stan or even you have projects or updates you want to share. So, mahalo.
Yeah, sure. I mean, Stan, you got a new album at the moment, or you're working on a new album? Or when are we going to hear some new songs drop?
Yeah, I'm working. I'm just finishing off my album. I'm actually doing two albums at the moment. I'm doing a Te Reo Māori album, all in Māori, and then doing another album. So looking forward to that. Should be out in the next few months. Just finalizing all the finishing touches. And I'm excited. New music, and just excited for this year and everything that it's got. There's a lot on the horizon, but
Thank you, kia ora. Mitchell, how about yourself? What are you working on right now?
Well, I'm just about to embark on a new documentary, which I can't say too much about, but hopefully it's going to be one about neurodiversity and children, about working in that area. So that's quite an exciting one to sink my teeth into next.
Yeah, well, keep us all informed. And for me, we're about to run our DocEdge industry events in the DocEdge Film Festival. So for those of you who are interested in learning about what's happening in the screen industry, please join us on the www.docedge.nz. our industry events start next week, and then after that our festival starts. We've got 83 of the world's films coming to the country. So thank you again. Thank you so much. Once again, thank you, Stan and Mitchell, for sharing your film and your story and your journey and your lives with us. Really appreciate it. Thank you, Pacific Islanders and Communication World Channel, for actually taking this opportunity to discuss the film and giving us the opportunity to have a dialogue today. Much appreciated. And, you know, thank you again. Kia ora, everyone. And have a really nice rest of the day wherever you are.
Thank you.
Kia ora. Bye.